So loops are very useful when you want to do a repetitive task many times. So suppose that you want to print a string, welcome to Java, a user-defined number of times. Like for instance, you had a scanner, you ask the user how many times you want me to tell you welcome to Java. And the user can enter 10 or can enter 100. And this really depends, the number of print statements that we have is depends on the number n. So there is an inefficient way to write it with an if statement. If the user entered one, print system.out.println once. If the user enters two, then system.out.println twice. But of course, you can't do this, let's say 255 times if the user entered a byte, or 2^32 if they entered an integer. So normally you should do this with a while loop or any loop, a for loop, a do while loop, and so on. And how do we do that? Basically, a while loop is like an if statement. We define something, some variable before the while loop, count is equal to zero. While the count is less than n, execute this block. It's like an if statement. If the condition is true, it gets in. It has an effect on the count, usually. Like for instance, we increment the count with one, and then we come back to the if statement, so to the condition. So this repeats executing that as many times as you basically have that condition as true. So for instance, if the user entered 10, this will check, is zero less than 10? Yes, prints once, then increments count to one. One less than 10, prints again, and so on 10 times. The moment that it becomes 10, the counter is 10, 10 less than 10 is false, and it continues with the rest of the code. So it actually prints 11 times because we start from zero. So what is an iteration? It's repeating a set of instructions a number of times or until some specific result is achieved, like the condition becomes false. So imagine before actually we had loops, like while loops, for loops, we had go-to statements. So really what this was doing was executing some code, and then instruction C can be a jump, a conditional jump. If the statement is true, jump to instruction A and rerun these instructions. Okay. That's exactly what we are doing, but with structural programming. So an iteration makes our code more practical, efficient, flexible. We can modify the loops with concise code. And another example is n factorial. So again, the user enters n, you have to print some number of you have to compute n factorial in an efficient way. You can do it without iteration very inefficiently. If the user entered one or zero, return one, otherwise do this multiplication, otherwise if n is three, multiply three with two with one, if n is four, multiply four with three with two with one, and so on. Very inefficient because you have all of these if statements, and instead of having a loop. So how do we do it with a loop? We basically start with factorial product equal with one. Then we have a variable I assigned one. While I is less than the n that the user entered, we multiply the factorial, the current factorial with I and increment I with one. So this is solving that same code that we saw before in seven statements. Basically, we have two statements to read the value, two statements to define the variables factorial and I. Then we have two statements in the loop that iterates to compute the product between one and the value of n that was entered by the user, and one statement to print the factorial, no matter what n is. N can be one or could be 50. It will work in the same way. Java has three types of loops, basic loops. It has another type that we will actually discuss later, which is for each loops. If you have a collection and you want to iterate over all the elements of the collection, you would use a variant of for, but for every variable that instantiates from the elements of the collection. All of these three types of loops that we will discuss today are similar. They have the same complexity, the same basically expressivity. Which one will you use? It's a matter of personal preference and convenience. So let's start with while loops. So basically while loops are like if statements, only the keyword that is used is while. So while the condition is true, we have the loop body, which usually contains some kind of assignment to the variable that is used in the condition. So you then don't have an infinite loop. So the condition modifies every time a little bit until we reach an end case and we exit from the loop. As a flow chart, the loop continuation condition is executed. If it's true, we execute the body of the loop, and then we return back to check the condition until the condition becomes false and we exit the loop. So for instance, if we want to print 100 times welcome to Java, we assign to a variable count 0, then while the count is less than 100, we print welcome to Java, and then we increment the count. Eventually, our count becomes 100, this condition becomes false, and we exit the loop. Let's trace it for three steps. Basically, we start with the count 0, 0 less than 2 is true, prints once welcome to Java, increments the count to 1, 1 less than 2 is still true, again prints welcome to Java, increments the counter to 2, 2 less than 2 is false, and we exit. This is why how while statements work. Any questions? One thing to be aware of is that real numbers are not exact. If you try to compare them with with integers, you will actually see that equality doesn't work between reals and integers all the time. It works when the number is exact, but when the number is actually implemented internally by basically subtraction or division, the real numbers cannot represent exactly, like for instance, 0.1. So consider the following code. We define double equal with 1, sum equal with 0. While the sum is different than 0, we increment the sum with the item, and we decrement with the item with 0.1. You would say that basically starting with 1 and decrementing from 0 with 0.1 at every step, it will eventually become 0. But that's not true, because 0.1 in IEEE standard implementation of decimal numbers is not precisely implemented. It's 0.1000000, and after many, many digits, 1 or 2. A digit different than 0. So what happens is that this item will not become 0. It will be a value that is very, very close to 0, like 0.00000 something at the end, 2 or 5 or 7. So there is no guarantee that this is exactly 0. So what happens in this while loop is that we will run in an infinite loop. So it will never finish. It's actually an infinite loop. And I can actually show you this. And the way to solve it is that you actually can modify this not equal to greater than. So as long as it's greater than 0, execute the inner loop. The moment that it becomes negative, exit. Okay. So let me show you how this works as the last thing today. I will also put a print statement inside so we can see the value of item. Okay. And run this. Stop it. So right at the beginning, I'm not even have that available. Actually, one thing that I can do is, let's see what happens if I modify this to greater. So now you can actually see, I started with 1 and then 0.9, 0.8. And then you see that it starts not to be 0.7, 0.7000001. And so on, like basically the moment that it becomes zero is not zero. It's actually 0.16 zeros and then a 138 and so on. So it's a value that is very close to zero, but is not equal with zero. So if my intent was that I stop at zero, with not equal doesn't stop at zero. What I did in the next step, I basically said, do it until it's a positive value. So the moment that is a negative value, it will basically exit. And that was done by comparison with greater than instead of comparison with not equal. Okay, that's all for today. It's 7:25. We'll continue with the rest of loops next class, the while loops and for loops. Thank you very much.